Didcot Parkway, Swindon, Chippenham, Bath Spa, Bristol Temple Meads, Filton Abbey Wood, Bristol Parkway, Newport.
I'm in Bristol now, and I don't know what time it is. It must be just like a bit before 8. You can hear in the background, if you can hear the cars, that's the M5. But Bristol is so well marked for cycles. It's a real cyclist city. It's another old railway trail. The train again. So I just cycled through the Tiddenham Tunnel, which is this one. It's very dark in there because they're trying to protect the bats, so the lighting is really low. But it's wonderful. It really reminds me of two tunnels in Bath, which is like the same concept. But yeah, very calm, very peaceful. And now I'm nearly in Tintern. Oh dear, where have you got? Where are you going? Heading to Goodrich and then to Tewkesbury. My legs are definitely not as fit as they were, they're doing alright. Love it so much when they do these train station stops and they keep the old train platform. Look at that. This is a really nice path actually. I have stopped off in Goodrich to see the castle. I'm knackered and I've still got a couple hours cycling to do. We'll see how that goes. This is where the portcullis drops down from. This castle is so fun because you can actually just walk around so much of it, which you often can't do in the ruins, or they're so ruined that all the ruins are laid down. But another one of my favourite castles, Corfe Castle, is also one you can walk around a lot in. Look at that. Steps to nowhere. This hill sucks. I hate this hill. I got up and pushed. Best sign I've seen all day. Very excited about being about an hour away from Tewkesbury. I made it to Tewkesbury. This is where I'm staying. It's so beautiful. They let me take the bike in. I offered to lock it up somewhere and they were like, no, no, just bring it in. This will do very nicely. There's no bedroom up here. But my voice is sleepy. It leads up to this gorgeous viewing point of Tewkesbury Abbey. Wow. Good morning. It's a little after the 6:30 a.m. mark. My legs feel so fresh. I really like this time of day. Definitely a morning person. Makes me think of that line, dark satanic mills. As a massive nerd, I really like how many signs they've got here along the walk about the history. Day two. Here we go. I think the theme of this trip is bridges. So many bridges. And almost all of them so weak that there's a traffic system. I'm in Langdon, I think. And I always love seeing phone boxes in the wild, but especially phone boxes that have been turned into little libraries. So great. Sometimes on my way to my grandparents, we used to drive through Upton, but often it was flooded because the Severn would flood, and then I think you couldn't get over the bridge or something. I can't remember, but there's the Malvern Hills over there. That's where we're going next. God, it's been ages since I saw those hills. And it's leading me down dirt path. It's the official name. GPS has sent me tramping through this cornfield, I think. Cows. Today has been about accepting, slowing down, and actually seeing it as a choice rather than like, oh, I'm delayed and running behind. I'm choosing to spend more time in a smaller square footage and then hop on the train. We're back on the road. I'd like to take this opportunity to say I love roads. Thank you for listening to my TED talk. Oh God, I took my jacket off because the sun is scorching. Okay, I was really resenting the GPS, but this is very nice. So much beeping. haven't they? Poo in the boot. Because it looks so different. And yet, like, the shape of it is kind of the same. And that's where the old bird bath was. Really weird. I think this is where the corner shop was. Like, all of my senses are telling me it was there, but obviously not anymore. God, it's so weird. Like, you know, things change, but still, there's Watery Lane. All of these things are so much further away in my memory from each other. There's Watery Lane. I used to go for walks down there. Oh my God, it's mad. Shrewsbury now, which is a very grand train station. Okay, so a big part of the reason why I came by Shrewsbury is because I really wanted to see this fine 16th century mansion. Free to enter. So that's the newest bit. I think this is the oldest bit. Elizabethan kitchen. It's a really good archway. I just want to write something about this place, you know. This is crazy. There's so many ruins in this country. What's this? These are latrines. So, I've become a latrine expert. Look at all that brickwork. Well, really new is a bit of a stretch. The new, the newest bit. God, it's so good. So this is the earliest surviving building, which it says was probably erected around the year 1200, and the first floor interior may have served as a bedchamber for the lord of the castle. Oh, I just love it. I love it so much. This whole video is going to be me just saying I love it. Side. This is the Elizabethan mansion. Robert Corbett inherited Morton Corbett in 1578 and, influenced by his extensive travelling, immediately began to transform his ancestral home. The broad front of this building was symmetrically planned and punctuated by huge grid windows. It was covered in rich classical detailing, some of it evidently copied from books on architecture printed in Europe. There was a high-pitched slate roof, partially concealed by tall gables. The principal chambers of the range included a great chamber and long gallery overlooked a new garden created by Robert beside the castle. A 1588 survey records that the garden had formal walks and central sundial with an orchard nearby. Traces of the garden are still faintly visible as earthworks in the neighbouring field. Robert died of the plague in 1583, and his brothers Richard and Vincent, who inherited the castle in turn, completed the range. It was repaired after the Civil War, but fell into ruin during the 18th century when the Corbett family chose to live elsewhere. Thank you to the nice people at English Heritage for putting that together. Wow, I'm just in love with this. So, off to the Airbnb now. Country roads, should be about 45 minutes. I think mostly flat and downhill, which is very exciting. Just came from that way. And I'm going that way. I have made it to Meathen Hall. All sorts of different levels, and it's attached to the main house. But it also feels very much like its own space. Oh, I love this painting. I need to have more paintings about natural light. Wow. I can hear my knee click, I think. View from above. We have a friend here. I wonder if he has a name. This is my room for the night, well, two nights. Very pleased with my decision to do two nights stay. There are lovely gardens as well. It's just beautiful. I've already hung my trusty jacket up. All the space for like the two items of clothing I have. There's a bath as well in one of the rooms. I mean, look at that. Look at that. Oh, I love it. Just realised, well, I just got my period. Thank you. Good morning. All going well here, beautiful day again, except there has been a slight mechanical, which is that the bolt, which I operate using an Allen key, has stripped. So completely mounted. Can't really tighten it. I did put tape over it. Well, I put a plaster over it because I ran out of tape. I put a plaster over it and then used hex glue on it, but it's just like there's no grip, no purchase whatsoever. Luckily, I'm about 10 minutes away from a bike shop. So really, of all the places for that to happen, it's great. The moment my bike seat goes down, I can feel the stress it's putting on my hip and my knee. That's why it's so important to have your bike seat properly raised up. I see so many people whose bike seats are so low and I just feel for their knees and their hips. So I'm gonna go to Bike Tech in Newport, hopefully get a new bolt, and then carry on. And my next stop after that is a National Trust house in Stafford. I might go through Stafford first because I think there's a castle there. And then yeah, go to this National Trust house, have proper break there, and then head onwards to the Beaks. I mean, just look at that. That is a useless bolt. Absolutely useless. This is Newport, where there is a bike shop, as well as many other things. But for my interest, it's mostly the bike shop. Back on the road again, and only a few signs that sometimes remind me we're in a pandemic. So this is Route 55 again, between Newport and Stafford. Stafford is my next stop. And this is just divine. We love it. I think it's an old trail road as well because I went under it, a little tunnel, but it just looks like it as well. I started to see the shape of the paths that used to be railways. I found a little bench along the Newport to Stafford Greenway, and I thought this is a good excuse as any to sort of stop for a bit. It's gorgeous. It's just really nice. It's so, like, obviously it's what I needed. It's what everyone needs. Everyone needs to be like somewhere different other than where they've been for a bit, and to have a really nice break and like a lot of physical activity. And just, I've met so many nice people. I feel quite emotional about this today. So when I got to Newport, the really nice guy at Bike Tech fixed my bolt in like 10 minutes, wouldn't let me pay for the service or the bolt or anything. And that was really lovely. And my bike is just so much better. I've been having trouble with the seat for like a couple of days, but then today it just, like, the seat wouldn't stay. Oh. Yeah, it's been a tough time. Like, and I don't just mean this year, I think what I mean is like the last 10 years, the last 20 years, the last 30 years. I think I'm realizing that there's been a lot of like tricky stuff that's been going on. So yeah, I'm gonna pause for a sec. Just had a really nice chat with someone for like 10-15 minutes about her rescue dog and her horse who got choked yesterday, which is apparently when the hay gets stuck and they have to try and get it out, and it has like mucus and stuff. Anyway, you learn all sorts of things. Yeah, I've had so many nice conversations with people, and I think I mentioned this in my Cornwall video, but like, that's so crucial to my happiness. And so when people say, like, when people talk about extroversion, I think what they think about is like, oh, you want to be having conversations with your friends all the time. And like, that's not necessarily it. It's also these like passing social constants of like the interactions you have with all of the different people you meet in a day. For a cyclist, like, you just encounter a lot of people when you're doing tours like this, like on the trail. talking to, like, for example, the people who ran where it was staying, just like being able to have these conversations again and again. Something I keep thinking about, and I think just because it was my dad's birthday yesterday, I keep seeing these men in like their 70s, and every time I have a conversation with them, I'm just kind of like, oh, that could be a version of you, that could be a version of you. It's odd. I think I'm like starting to place that into it as well. So yeah, oh, nice little sunbeam. If I've learned anything from the like decision I took to make, like, take the train that second day, whatever it was, and then having this really packed, wonderful day of cycling yesterday around Telford, is that I should take breaks. And I have noticed that something that I was going to mention whenever I finally make the cycle planning video, but I have noticed something I don't do when planning my routes is plan enough time for like rest and meals, and also just like if I'm going to a certain site. So if I'm like going to see a ruin or something, in my head when I'm calculating the length of the trip, I don't think of it as like, and then I'll have a half hour to wander around this place or an hour to wander around this place. I think of it as, I'm going to get to this place at 1, and then I'm going to get to this place at 2. Someone on Twitter told me that she hasn't seen her grandpa in over a year, and he lives in Stafford. And it just made me think a lot about a lot of you who haven't seen relatives in a year, and I might be going through where they live. So hello to all the people you love who you haven't been able to see. I don't know how to pronounce this, Shugborough Estate. It's a National Trust home. And I'm in Cannock Chase, which is, I believe, an area of outstanding natural beauty. Hello from August, when I am editing this video, and have sadly just realised that when my laptop crashed a month ago, it lost the remainder of the footage for this video, which is really gutting because it was beautiful. It took us all the way through to the Peak District and then a week in Bakewell. I'm hoping that there is somewhere I haven't looked yet where I have backed up this footage, because I usually back it up in 3 places. So I'm holding on to that hope, but even if it doesn't happen, it's okay. These things happen in the world of digital media and of other media too. So I'm trying to be like a plant or a tree in the wind and just sort of go with where the wind is going, but not let it necessarily topple me. That's very regal. I think it's because I'm wearing this, and I've also been reading the Hilary Mantel, Thomas Cromwell books, like Wolf Hall, Bring Up the Bodies, and I'm now on The Mirror and the Light, and
I think they're rubbing off on me a little bit. yeah, all that to say, not the end of the world. I am sad about it, but there's a couple big cycling videos coming up. There's the video from my North England trip where I went to the Yorkshire Dales, met up with Sana, and then left her behind and cycled onto the Lake District and then up to Carlisle. And then there's the most recent trip where I began in Carlisle and cycled all the way up through mainland Scotland to John O'Groats through the Highlands. And that's absolutely beautiful. And that's a trip I've just returned from. As well as I'm going to make the Telford cycling day that I mentioned in this video, I think, its own video. I've got cycling Q&A to upload. I've got videos about books to upload. It's not all cycling. Other vlogs, just like loads of other stuff coming. I am just a bit sad to have lost this footage because it doesn't mean I didn't do it though, you know? That's, I think, what I have to remind myself. Like, it doesn't mean that I didn't complete this immense task and fun trip for myself. And I remember what it looked like at Golden Hour in the Peak District with lambs in lambing season just bleating away at me. I remember all of that, and that's what matters really, isn't it? I also wanted to add a little note at the end of this to give a little context. It was filmed, I think I departed on the 12th or 13th of April, which was right when our winter lockdown was lifted here to the point that we were allowed to stay overnight somewhere that wasn't our home, as long as it was self-catering. And like so many people, it was a really tough third lockdown. I found it really difficult. So to be able to travel somewhere else and be in a different space with different people and just seeing different parts of the country felt like such luxury, and it felt like a real reintroduction to the world for me and to being, I think. That's like the end of that sentence, to being. It was wonderful. So that adds a little context there. I hope you're all doing well. I hope you're taking care of yourselves as best you can. And I hope you're being kind to yourself and to other people as well. Happy August, favourite month of the year. So even if you don't love it, I hope you'll love it a little bit more on my behalf. Gonna end it there. Bye bye. I'm recording this in quick time, by the way. Old school.